When do we start?
Welcome, Gothamites, to another episode of the Arkham Sessions. My name is Brian Ward. With me, as always, is the psychologist to the superheroes, superheroines, and supervillains of Gotham City and beyond, Dr. Drea Letamendi. Hello, Drea.
Hi, Brian. How are you?
Doing well, thanks. Despite the fact that... okay, look, here's the thing. We're going to cover Thor, The Dark World, which is the second Thor movie, the second movie in Phase 2 of the MCU. I have to be honest, we watched it last night. That was the second time I have ever seen the movie. I saw it opening night in theaters, never felt the need to see it again. It's one that I always just sort of skipped over. So I watched it again with the hopes that it would be a better film, a better story, because we're looking at it from a psychological perspective. I get the opportunity to really analyze characters. And guess what?
What?
It's still a movie I would skip every time I pass by it on the television.
Yikes.
There isn't a whole lot to say for this movie for me. What's funny is this movie has a lot that could have been going for it, but I feel like most of its characters are robbed of amazing moments or opportunities.
Can I ask you, though, apart from the movie being very insignificant, and I say that not to downplay or minimize the characters themselves or the writers, but what does this offer the bigger story? Because I was looking for some connection to, now that we've been through several phases of the MCU, I was looking for those moments of clarity, that those aha moments that would help me connect some of the pieces
to, like, the bigger MCU story.
Yes, I mean, the obvious piece is the Infinity Stone.
That's it.
But is there anything else that you can draw from this and say, oh, this is why this is what makes this film important to the bigger story?
No, not really. Without going into future movies, which we're not technically supposed to do, this sets up the ether. It sets up the reality stone, right? It doesn't really do a lot more for the development of these characters. I mean, you're going to set up certain moments. We're going to talk about people like Loki here in a second, I'm sure. And Loki's actually probably one of my biggest problems with this entire movie. But
now be careful, because I'm about to say that Loki is probably the most interesting character in this movie.
And that very well may be true, and that's actually part of the reason why I think he's my biggest problem with the movie. I think let's talk about the fact that Thor can't go anywhere without Loki at this point. I mean, no matter how much he tries, it really makes Thor out to be an idiot. You know Thor's been the big brother who is constantly manipulated by his little brother, says he has love for him, then he doesn't. He had trust for him, now he doesn't, but he needs him to accomplish something, which means he's got trust. He's got some amount of trust for Loki. Mm-hmm. He trusts him to get him through a secret path. He trusts him to do certain things. He trusts him with a secret plan that's going to make it seem like Loki betrayed him, but then he didn't.
Are you fatigued with...
I'm so tired of it.
The brother, the unhealthy brotherly relationship, are you sort of fatigued with that trope?
And not just unhealthy brotherly relationship,
yeah.
Unhealthy paternal relationship as well. Like the whole system. Family is yeah. I'm just tired of the family at this point. And and Loki is the key element of that because Loki's the one who keeps stirring the pot. Now that doesn't mean that I don't like Tom Hiddleston. It doesn't mean that I don't like the Loki character. It's that I wouldn't mind a Thor story without having to deal with Loki so much. I don't need him to be imprisoned in a dungeon at the beginning of the movie, only to midway through the movie have to be the last resort to help Thor out. It's just an obvious case of this character blew up with fans.
Oh,
and now okay. That character is robbing other people of their big moments. And I'm going to get to the biggest complaint I have in the entire movie a little bit later.
Okay.
But it directly involves Loki robbing another character of a huge moment. It's so funny that we got right into this is
well, I think it, we're that very, kind of story. And I think our reactions are very different. I've now seen it twice in the last few weeks because I was preparing to write an entire article on Loki. And so I went back and watched all the films he was in.
Yeah.
I'd say that this is the film that contains most of his, his scenes.
Yeah.
Somewhere someone had said that in the entire universe before the Loki series, he's in a couple dozen minutes. Like yeah. he's actually, we think of him as a bigger character, but he doesn't have a ton of screen time. And I'd say that this is the most screen time in any of the films. Sure. I could be wrong.
I have
that's
a problem.
The impression I have.
Yeah, I have a problem with that analysis because you don't need screen time for your character to be the weight of the movie. You know, like
he's not in
the Avengers as much as, it's like, but he is the villain of the, like everything yeah. he does motivates all the other characters. And you know.
I think what I'm saying is people believe or they exaggerate his presence, his screen time in yeah. the MCU. And in fact, he's not as present, but his impact is
very present.
And it's yeah. what seems to frustrate you, but kind of delights me. Like everything you said about what is frustrating to you actually creates, like stirs in me some of the thoughts and curiosities around their family.
Yeah.
And I would agree with you. I don't know if that makes the best cinema. Like, I'm not sure that the storytelling is the best for the overarching story.
Yeah.
But for me, as a psychologist, watching this and knowing that people may be fatigued with the backstabbing and the back and forth
and the fake
trust
deaths.
Mistrust and the fake deaths. How many times is he going to fake his death?
It's just become so formulaic.
It seems cinematically formulated. To me, it seems absolutely consistent with the family systems theory and the behaviors that we've seen up till then. And I hate to use the very overused, boring statement about people's behavior, but people tend to show you who they are through behavior and they tend to behave in consistent ways.
Sure.
And so I'm pretty confident that the goal was not to fatigue us. I'm confident that the goal was to really characterize Loki in a certain way. But I think you're right that then you have these victims, these survivors of his behavior that become fatiguing and somewhat exhausting to be around.
Here's the problem that I really have with it is the continuity of it and the chronology of Asgardians. Asgardians, we've already established, live thousands of years compared to humans. Odin downright dehumanizes Jane Foster in this movie because he believes that she's basically an insect compared to other Asgardians. You know, she's going to die and she's going to die real quick compared to us. So why even bother? And that overall big picture is the problem that I have with the consistency of Loki's character. Because when we look at how often he does this, it is within seconds of one another compared to, you know, the human lifestyle. If, I mean, think about the fact that there was the Battle of New York. And the very first time we see him in this movie, he is now on trial in front of Odin for the Battle of New York, for the betrayal of Asgard, for the betrayal of Midgard, for the betrayal of the Nine Realms. He is immediately taken by Thor to Asgard for trial, is now having that trial, and is still belligerent toward Odin, is still consistently Loki, thrown in prison for a matter of a couple days, instantly back at work with Thor, instantly betraying Thor, quote unquote, and that's more manipulating the audience than it is
right.
Thor, but then dies again. Sacrifices himself. Now think about the fact that these characters have been alive for thousands of years. And he's doing it again, like, the next day.
It's pathological.
Give it some time.
Well, and I'd say
I might buy into Thor's willingness to work with him again. But it's instantaneous. And you're right. It's pathological.
It's totally pathological.
I let him out of the cell, and he's just doing it again.
Yes.
And that's the part that's tiring to me, is knowing that this entire universe, for as long as they've been alive, has been consistently this. You know, this pattern.
One note.
It's all one note.
I get it. I enjoy it because I want to see characters who are flawed and who struggle and who, despite some interest in changing, still go back to those ways.
Yeah.
And I can see what maybe what we can do is look for development, like look for some kind of knowledge here that will help us to give value to this film. It is entertaining. It's definitely one you can skip if you're looking for the storytelling. I don't think it adds very much to the bigger story. But I do think, I'm not saying it's one of my favorite films, but I'm saying if you want to study Loki, And I do, because that's just who I am. If you want to study Loki, this is the movie to watch.
Yeah. Well, okay. So then let's talk about our ultimate villain here, right? Because we were introduced to Malekith, the dark elf, who was this malevolent ruler of dark elves. And it's established that before basically the Big Bang, before there was anything, before there was light, there was total darkness, and that's where the dark elves ruled. And that's where they lived, that's where they reigned, that's where they thrived. And then there was essentially the Big Bang, and now light exists, and the dark elves were thrown into chaos and were overthrown by Thor's grandfather, Bor, and
his name was Bor?
Bor, yeah.
B-O-R. Thor's grandfather was Bor.
Well, think about mythology, think about think about where names came from for the longest time, where you would be, it's not uncommon to have very similar familial names. I mean, just look at Tolkien. I mean,
yeah.
Half the characters in those stories are basically the same name, with maybe a letter change. I mean, let's see about the original dwarves: Feely, Keely, Ori, Dori, Nori, Owen, Glowen, Biffer, Boffer, Bombor. Let's see who else: Thorin. That, you know,
yeah,
but and I'm sure there's another one or there's another one that I'm missing, but you know, they're all the same name. You know, it's like, these are definitely familial names. So you've got Bor, who had Odin, and Odin had Thor. Although that's interesting, because you've got Thor, Odin's son.
Well, he's the son of Odin.
No, that I get.
Yeah.
But that would make Odin Bor's son. I'm Odin Bor's son. Doesn't quite have the same ring to it. Okay, so yeah, you've got Malekith, who has basically waged war on the universe because he wants to return the universe to total darkness, where presumably he would then reign because he's the most malevolent of the Dark Elves. And in the comics, actually, despite his successes or failures, and the Dark Elves actually elect him to be their king because they are terrified of him. And when it comes to Dark Elves, like, respect comes with just how scared we are of you. And so it makes sense. This is a character that is going to throw the universe into total darkness so that he can reign. Interestingly, this is a character that I think could have been great, but this movie completely wastes him. He just becomes the bad guy who wants to turn the universe into darkness. You know, there are analyses of him online. We had someone tweet us just a couple of days ago, right before we rewatched this movie. And I appreciate this tweet because I went back and I got to listen to some of this podcast. A person that follows us named Politics with Paxton said, "I have really enjoyed your podcast and the complex psychological analyses you provide. As you examine the films in the MCU, I highly recommend that you look into the psychology of Malekith after being subjected to dehumanization in Thor 2. And he links us to his podcast, which is Pop Culture Perspectives with Paxton. Now, I have to admit, I've not listened to the entire episode. It's a hefty one, and we literally just watched this movie and we're recording, so I haven't had time. Mm-hmm. It's like a 2-hour episode, but I have listened to a significant amount of it. And Paxton brings up some really interesting points that suddenly makes Malekith a more interesting character. Some of it is based on leaps that you have to make to make Malekith a more interesting character. But I do appreciate, he essentially compares Malekith and Malekith's people, the Dark Elves, to the dehumanized peoples of Earth in history. Mm-hmm. And how it's a very interesting analysis and an observation when we realize that the person telling us the story of Malekith, especially at the beginning of the movie, is Odin. So Odin is recounting history that he wasn't even there for. It was his father that fought this war. And so you the audience have to presume that Thor and Odin and all these characters have learned this story based on the victors of mm-hmm. this war and this history, who have inevitably painted themselves out to be the heroes. This podcast, and it's possible that there are other people who have posited the same thing online, but this podcast posits that essentially the light is toxic to these people, and these people are now fighting for the ability to live.
This matter is a resource to them that allows their community to thrive.
Right. By taking light away from the universe, you're giving the Dark Elves the opportunity to live. Mm-hmm. And Bor, being a colonizer, has decided to overthrow everyone. And we know this to be true because we know that the Nine Realms are protected by Asgard, and the other, you know, we've seen Jotunheim is yep. not what it once was. They're a bit terrified of Asgard. So we know Asgard to be a bit of a tyrannical colonizer of a nation. And presumably you have Malekith, who is now actively leading his people and sacrificing his own people, because we do see that he sacrificed his own ships, his own people, in order to hopefully destroy the Asgardians while he escaped in the beginning of the movie. And this is painted as a cold-blooded attempt to rule the universe, when really you could say that this is a guy who has such a strong belief system and desire to see his own race continue, that he is willing to sacrifice some in order to mm-hmm. to get the bigger win. And we know for a fact that Odin's the same way, because when the Dark Elves start to attack Asgard, Thor even says, "You're no different than Malekith, because you're willing to, how many of our people have to die in order to win your war?" And Odin comes back and says, "As many as it takes." So he's also willing to sacrifice thousands of his own people in order to say that they won. And he says, "Well, you know, what's different between you and Malekith?" And he says, "Well, the difference between us is I'm going to win." And so, so all of this is really interesting.
Yeah. What an interesting take on this. I actually would love to listen to the podcast that you mentioned, because it also helps us to understand the psychology of Loki a bit more. He is now,
it comes back to Loki.
I mean, I think what I'm hearing you say is that this family is, observing this narrative where they are the rightful rulers of these nine realms. Their vision is to protect, and they almost use this sort of royal language, this royal culture, to justify their oversight of, the nine realms. Loki, and folks need to go back to our original Thor episode if this is a spoiler, I doubt it is for most people, but Loki is not Odin's son. Loki is actually the son of
Laufey.
Who is a ruler of one of these communities that has been ravaged by the Asgardians.
Yeah, he's a frost giant from Jotunheim. Yeah,
and you see, you know, there are some important moments in the films where Loki begins to show, I would say, sort of this ancestral connection to his own people, whether it's through, having the skin color come back. Like he's a magical being, and he can basically look like anything he wants. But when he's dying or pretending to die in this film, Dark World, he also becomes kind of bluish. Mm-hmm. Right. And so there are these callbacks to his true ancestry. But yeah. Nonetheless, what I'm gathering is that his parents remind him that he's, in maybe subtle ways, that he's from a different community, and that he is actually from a place, a planet, a community that they dehumanized.
100%.
And so how could he not begin to interpret or internalize those feelings of dehumanization as a member of their family?
Yeah. Well, and it's funny. You focus on Loki, and I think you're right. I also think about Thor and the fact that we have genuinely seen an arc in his character. We've seen a guy who just goes and battles other communities for the sake of battling other communities, because for him it's fun. To genuinely understanding what it means to battle other communities. In fact, right now he is, when we're introduced to Thor in this particular movie, he is at war with his gang because of the trouble that Loki started. So now he's basically trying to clean up this mess, and it requires putting down uprisings around the universe. And you can see that he's not quite as interested in fighting anymore, where he was very interested in taking on as many as he could before. Now he's willing to take down the biggest ones so that the others surrender. The interesting thing here is that there is the moment where he's talking with Odin about the sacrifices of his people, and he basically says something that I think really shows the difference between Odin's ruling style and Thor's upcoming ruling style. Odin seems to believe that to protect Asgardians, he needs to conquer the other realms to prevent them from hurting his people. And now Thor seems to believe that while we might rule these other realms, it is our jobs to protect everyone. So it becomes a benevolent ruler.
And I think the difference is that Thor has gone beyond the, I keep calling it the frostbite. It's
the Bifrost.
It's the Bifrost. He is experiencing other cultures. He falls in love with a human being. Mm-hmm. So
which is considered an animal or an insect to someone right. like Odin.
Yeah. And I think this does build in him some of those bigger ideas about harmony with other people and thinking less about himself as a superior.
Yeah.
Now there are ways in which he, like, they live for 5,000 years. Humans don't, you know, there are these clear differences, but I think just in terms of connecting to Jane Foster and finding the humanity in her and falling in love with her, all of that, I think, builds into his discovery of parts of himself that are probably more compassionate, more about community building, less yes. about ruling and, yeah. and the narcissism that has kind of been honestly driven by his parents.
Could we call that also what I think it is, which is, I think this is a tale of racism. I think Odin is racist. I think the fact that he doesn't want Thor to waste his time with other beings, he wants him to marry within his own. He wants to prevent Thor from going outside of their own culture. He specifically wants him to get together with Sif. Mm-hmm. And on the page, it might make sense. Sif is also a warrior. Sif is also certainly a worthy companion to someone like Thor. It's almost like she has been bred to be the soulmate for the upcoming king. And yet Thor's just not that into her. And you can tell she's very much into him. Like, this is what she believed was going to happen. She gives Jane Foster the side eye quite a few times, but also is willing to help Jane because she helped on Earth before. She is helping her future king betray the current king. So, I think this is also a tale of the old generation basically dying out to usher in a new generation, a new way of thinking in people, the way that happens with history. We become a bit more progressive in the way that we think as each generation takes over. And
Loki.
Yeah, come on back to Loki.
No, I think you make some really great points. Mainly, you know, this undercurrent of trying to preserve historical rule and really being on the attack and kind of trying to maintain this sense of rulership over these other planets, these realms, these communities and peoples, for really no other reason than they believe they're superior.
Yeah. Agreed. I feel like we've basically talked about everyone right here. You know who gets robbed in this movie is Jane Foster, this brilliant scientist who is just the emotional football in this movie. It
doesn't start off good. I really dislike the trope or the laziness of her being infected by this dark matter.
Yeah.
I think there's some resolution toward the end. There's some overcoming of that trope and maybe even subverting that trope a little bit, but being the victim of this dark matter that then kind of lives inside her, she's poisoned by it. It's infiltrating her body. She is, now luckily they didn't go so far as to kind of make her zombified and, yeah, and completely lacking will, which I hate. When they do to
or evil
to,
like,
women.
They didn't pull an Avengers and make, yeah, her like, now she's part, now the ether is controlling her or,
right,
anything like that. It was more the ether would protect itself by defending her, but it didn't change her personality. She wasn't Hawkeye'd.
No
the way that she could have been.
No, but there were moments in the beginning of the film during which she was just useless, and I don't mean that as a, I mean just in what was done to her.
You've got a character who is introduced to us by pining over a character she hasn't seen in a couple of years. She's never gotten over Thor, and right away it leaves a bad taste in your mouth, and so she's pining over this character she hasn't seen in a couple of years. She then uses her scientific knowledge to go looking for these anomalies, these sort of phasic anomalies, and then gets herself into trouble by having the ether put inside of her. And then she's basically the lady in the medical bed for the rest of the
yeah,
movie.
Yeah, that's the first half of the movie.
Yeah, and even when she's not in the medical bed, they are once again talking ill of her, like right there with her in the room. And she, you know, she is mistreated throughout the film, and maybe this leads to Paxton's point that the Asgardians dehumanize everybody. Of course, you've got Frigga, who seems to be the benevolent, maternal character that just wants to nurture everyone, and even going so far as Loki. She was clearly, Loki was hers, and she was his favorite parent, and she taught him magic. And even when he's told that she'll never see him again because he's in prison, she makes her way down there via
magic. I mean, she's not, she has a phantom self that can be
the same
in
way
the
he
cell
does
with him.
Yeah.
I like those moments because I guess one could watch that and say, well, why doesn't she just go down there physically to be with him? A part of this is that's their shared language. It's kind of, yeah, endearing that she meets him where he's at.
She probably taught him how to do that,
yes,
in the first,
yeah,
place.
Yeah, so it's totally fitting that's how she manifests and that's how she connects with him.
But she also, and it sort of shows her place within the rulership as well. She's queen, but she still can't undo what her husband,
yeah,
has decreed.
There's definitely some sexism here with, yeah, the clear desires and wants of her, yeah, but the limited power that she has.
Yeah.
I think things would be quite different if she had more say in the rulership. She, I do want to note that while I think it's their shared language for her to manifest as a phantom or as an illusion, it also reminds us that Loki holds very fragile relationships. And so it may be known or it may be understood that real person to person contact might be something he can't tolerate and would push against or would have a difficult time with.
Yeah.
So she finds ways to connect with him that I think most of us would find faulty and lacking and unsupportive. Like, why can't you physically be here with me? But I think is a way to acknowledge that's what he can tolerate. That is the presence he can understand and be comforted with or comforted by without being reactive, which is what we see with him and Thor. Thor is so pushy. Thor is like, I'm going to be right up there and mesh with you. And that's not something Loki can handle. So I see how Frigga is actually, unfortunately, I say unfortunately because she doesn't last too long in this film, but she is a character, or she is a person in Loki's life who's able to connect with him at his level, at the level of his needs.
Yeah.
And who probably would be a hopeful pathway to him getting better.
And unfortunately, not within world, but within the context of the filmmakers, she is just a tool to bring Loki back into the story. Like, she is her death.
Yeah.
And it's a needless death. And by the way, it's basically a deus ex machina for Malekith, because she hands Malekith his ass. I mean, she is clearly Asgardian. She very well may have even been a Sith at one point, which makes you really wonder what Sith might become in the future had she been with Thor. Because we're made to believe that Frigga is, again, this sort of nurturing, loving character, but she has very clearly been trained in combat, and she goes up against this general king, and he really never gets an opportunity to be in the upper hand. She puts him right up against the wall and makes herself very known to be a formidable foe to him, and for a brief moment you're cheering her agency, and then a giant beast comes from behind and captures her and is ultimately the one that kills her when he thrusts a sword through her. And unfortunately at that moment, she becomes a tool to show us Loki's rage, to show us that Loki is now willing to switch sides and fight with the Asgardians because of the death of his mother. So now it's, again, we're dealing with an emotional football. Loki is now swapping back and forth, yes, emotionally.
And I'm delighted you say this, of course, because what this tells me is that they're successful in creating a character who, in my mind, is borderline that way, who is so undifferentiated emotionally that he's sort of switching and swapping sides and unstable to the degree that you're seeing. And again, you're fatigued by it. Imagine the people in real life who live with a person like this, who has someone like this in their family, or who's married to someone like this, where the instability and the fragility means that they do have these sort of reactive responses and are and switch back and forth or split in different ways that can cause a lot of exhaustion among the people around them.
So while my absolute least favorite moment in this movie involves Loki, my favorite moment in this movie also involves Loki. And it is a not so subtle metaphor for putting up barriers emotionally. And that's when Thor goes down to visit Loki, and the room is pristine and Loki looks like himself. And Thor knows that it's not right and says, you know, no more illusions. And suddenly that magical illusion disappears and we see that the room is demolished and Loki is all sooty and worn down and emotionally drained, sitting in the corner mourning his mother. Mm-hmm. And so you have a very, again, not so subtle visual representation of what it means to pretend to be okay while on the inside you're destroyed. And so I enjoyed that moment. It's a little bit of a slap in the face, a little on the nose, but it's a great, great visual representation. Mm-hmm. Okay, so since I've talked about it a couple of times, and since it's very clear this episode is about Loki again,
let me just reframe it. I think that this is about Thor and Loki, and you nailed it at the beginning. This constant push and pull, the trust, mistrust, the rage, the love, you know, the dynamics between the two characters really, in my mind, take us to the concept of family systems. A lot of times we focus on the individual and how the individual is developed emotionally, but we rarely talk about family systems, which is the concept that it's not just the individual that we're studying and talking about, but really the members of the family and how they relate to one another and how their emotions are intertwined, some would say interlocked. So as one person worsens, the other person may react to that, may be impacted by that. As one of the members of the family improves emotionally, it has a cascading effect on family members. That's a very, very sort of like quick summary of family systems. But I think that's what's new to our conversation, because I know we've talked about Loki a bunch, we've talked about Thor a bunch. This could be an opportunity for us to better understand family systems theory, which is probably now, you know, 60 years in the field of psychology in particular. You know, I want to name that it's marriage and family therapists who know this work really well and who utilize family systems in their counseling services.
This is the part that I hate. This is the moment that I strongly dislike in this movie.
Oh, I thought you meant about our podcast.
This is the part that I hate about our podcast, Drea.
Okay.
When you take over and start your science mumbo jumbo.
What did you not like about the movie?
The end. When all is said and done, we have spent a movie with, again, a character betraying his father, his king, and opting to fight for Asgard in the way that he feels would protect the most Asgardians. And Odin coming to realize that his ways are possibly archaic and should not be anymore. And he tries to hand Thor the throne. He says, look, clearly you have made yourself known to be a better king and a wiser king than I have ever been. Despite the fact that you once said that there would be no wiser king than me, you have proven yourself wrong. And he tries to hand Thor the throne. Let's take a listen to this little moment here that I pulled up.
Father, I cannot be king of Asgard. I will protect Asgard and all the realms with my last and every breath, but I cannot do so from that chair. Loki, for all his grave imbalance, understood rule as I know I never will. The brutality, the sacrifice, it changes you. I'd rather be a good man than a great king.
Is this my son I hear, or the woman he loves?
When you speak to, I never hear mother's voice. This is not for Jane, father. She does not know what I came here to say. Now forbid me to see her or say she can rule at my side. It changes nothing.
One son who wanted the throne too much, another who will not take it. Is this my legacy?
Loki died with honor. I shall try to live the same. Is that not legacy enough?
It belongs to you, if you are worthy of it.
I shall try to be.
I cannot give you my blessing, nor can I wish you good fortune.
I know.
If I were proud of the man my son had become, even that I could not say. would speak only from my heart. Go, my son.
Thank you, Father.
This is a very sweet moment. And this is a moment of self-realization. And this is a moment of him trying to hand over the reign of Asgard and presumably the Nine Realms to his son. His son realizing that now is not the time for that to happen. So it's self-actualization and realization of both parts. Thor saying, no, I need to go elsewhere. I need to continue to do things elsewhere. Odin sort of knowing what that means, that sort of means that Jane Foster is going to continue to be in the picture, doesn't condone it, but also unofficially gives his approval. This is a wonderful moment for Odin.
Mm-hmm.
Except it's not Odin. We find out it's Loki. Loki has come home in disguise as a guard who presumably found Loki's body, took over the identity of this character, came home and said, your son's dead. Odin.
And by the way, observed the reactions of the community, his parents, family members.
Yeah.
Well, Frigga's been passed away, but
yeah.
So he deliberately,
which we talked about before, chooses, the pseudo side.
Yeah. He deliberately chooses to be the person to make that announcement in order to observe the reactions.
Right. So here's the problem that I have. For starters, part of the audio revealed a moment that I don't believe Loki was ever there for. Loki was never there when Odin said that Thor would be a wiser king in the first Thor. Loki was gone. And so...
Okay, but isn't that quite an understanding?
No, but he says, you once said, like he pulls back firsthand account, firsthand knowledge, says, you once told me that there would be no wiser king than me. And Loki is now quoting that back to Thor. Loki wasn't there.
I imagine he said that multiple times.
Okay.
Loki remembers this.
All right. But we, the audience, are meant to remember the end of Thor.
You're right.
It's a specific moment. Loki wasn't there for. And it now shows that Loki has a better understanding of Thor and what Thor needs to hear to go away. Like, he is now so manipulative that he knows if I offer this guy the throne now, because what if Loki had offered him the throne and Thor took it? Loki's plan would be screwed.
Sure.
But he knows that if he offers Thor the throne now, Thor has now reached a level of self-actualization that he knows, I don't need the throne right now. I will come back for it later. I need to go away. That then gives Loki the opportunity to rule Asgard as Odin for a period of time. He then goes so far as to give Thor all of the emotional encouragement, you know, positive reinforcement that Thor's ever needed. He says all the right things.
That Thor had wanted his own father to tell him.
To tell him.
Now, why does Loki, this bother you? I'm so curious.
It bothers me for a couple of reasons. It robs Odin of the character moment of, you know, it's not Odin saying these things.
Yeah.
Whereas it's a much more beautiful moment between father and son, older generation to new generation. It's a beautiful moment between them. They're both having realizations. They're both coming to an understanding with one another. And then for it all to be robbed, for it to be a lie on one side, is not a great payoff. And here, by the way, this is going to blow your mind. Apparently, according to some production notes, this was a reshoot.
Mm-hmm.
Loki was supposed to remain dead until test audiences did not like that he didn't come back. So that moment very easily could have been written to be Odin.
Yeah. So and it was robbing this it's moment literally from Odin.
The popularity, the fans' popularity with Loki or obsession with Loki literally robbed Anthony Hopkins and Odin of this moment. You know, like,
oh dear.
Like now it's Loki instead of Odin, and it's all because we the people need yeah. more of this character.
Well, let me tell you something that is not going to shock you.
Okay.
I loved it.
I know. I know.
And I loved it. Okay, let me say two things about this. It's very specific. This is why it works for me. When Loki was dying in the arms of Thor, his brother, he tells him, well, Thor tells Loki, I'll tell our father what you did here. Like you essentially, you know, sacrificed yourself for us and for the kingdom. Like you did something really meaningful and selfless. I'm going to tell our father. And Loki, knowing that he's actually not going to die, Loki knowing that he's using an illusion, that he's using trickery to then eventually take over the throne.
I pulled it for you.
Better said, better than he says it. Yeah.
Yeah. You want to hear it? Here we go.
I'll tell Father what you did here today. I didn't do it for him.
Now, some of that, yes, is manipulative.
Some of it.
Some of it is, but if you. I think if you perceive the needs of this, of Loki as the brother, right, who has all of these unmet needs, if you see it as him in a vulnerable place, taking that opportunity to be honest, knowing that he has this bigger plan, knowing that he can always take it back, knowing that this is only one small piece of maybe an even more intolerable, vulnerable moment. I guess what I'm trying to say is he's not putting it all out there. He is relying on the relief and sort of the idea that he can take this back. He can come back from this. But he does tell his brother that his brother's approval matters to him.
Yeah.
Right? I think there's some honesty to that. But sure. He has to do it in this whole scheme. And this is his psychology. In order to be vulnerable and candid and loving with someone, he has to do it wrapped up in this huge illusionist magical scheme. Yeah. That's the only way he can do it, right?
Yeah.
So he does this, and later as Loki is impersonating his father, he takes that moment to give Thor what Thor needs. And you might say, and that's the second thing I want to say, is you might say is like, how does Loki, why would Loki know any of this? Well, Loki happens to be emotionally intelligent. I think Loki is underestimated because, well, he has this pathology. So how could he really know about people? He actually knows about people very, very well.
Yeah.
And I think he would know what Thor would want to hear.
Right.
And tries to serve him that in this moment.
And that's one thing I want to ask you about, though, is does it make it any less real, or does it make it any less, I don't want to say real. Is it, if it's manipulative, is it less effective to the person receiving it?
Well, the intent is not for Thor to ever find out. Right, I know right. He does later, or no, he may or may not know later.
Right, but if you know what Thor needs to hear, and you say it, whether you believe in it or not, because you have to believe at this point that all of this is a grander scheme to rule Asgard the way that he feels like he should have always been a king.
Yeah.
So he's really just telling Thor. He's not telling Thor what he genuinely believes to be true. He's telling Thor what Thor needs to hear. Now, does that make those statements less impactful or less effective to the person hearing the statements. Thor walks away believing these words. So the manipulation, the lie, the white lie or whatever in this case is not harmful to Thor, right?
It doesn't do him any harm. In fact, it's very validating and encouraging.
Yeah.
And I don't know if this answers your question, but I think it's helpful for me to realize that Loki knows, as Loki, as the person and the brother Loki, he's unable to provide that fatherly trusting approval of his own brother.
Yeah.
He has to do it in
a lie.
Yes, he has to do it in the figure of his father. And I think this is why family systems is really, really apparent here, is that Loki understands the relationship between Odin and Thor and knows that in this conversation, Loki is going to have to admit to the dynamics of the family. Let's admit that Thor would be the better king. Let's admit that, and Thor then can admit, you know, Loki, I think he has a really amazing comment about Loki. He's unbalanced in his ways, but Loki definitely understands ruling. Like Loki definitely has a good sense of his quest for superiority.
Well, and let's ask the question. I mean, we can't answer it fully until we see an upcoming movie, but would Loki actually make a bad king? I mean, I don't know that he would. He requires the worship, but all of his people, you know, could potentially, like, Loki is not out for colonization. He is not looking to acquire more kingdom. So the question is, would Loki actually make a bad king? We don't know. Like, we'll find out.
We'll find out. But and lastly, let me say that as much as you dislike and feel robbed by that scene, and I totally get it.
I'm not personally robbed. Odin was robbed.
Odin was robbed.
I simply observed the larceny.
Yeah, I feel that it also gives us some kind of resolution to, or a continued resolution to, the relationship with the brothers.
Yeah, I guess.
Both of them being in a safe place, able to tell, at least for Loki, able to tell his brother that he approves of him and he cares for him. He's able to say those words. And yes, he's doing it in a different body.
But I don't believe, I don't know that we are meant to believe that any of it's true. So it's not a resolution between brothers. It's one brother telling the other brother what he needs to hear in order to get him to go away. It's not Loki saying what he's always wanted to say to his brother, but having to do it behind a mask. It's Loki telling his brother, Asgard's covered. You can leave. Go ahead. Go be in love with your woman, your human woman, because that means you won't be here and I'll be able to rule Asgard. Like and I think that's what upsets me because I don't need the resolution between brothers at this point. I need the resolution between the other members. Like, I need the resolution between Odin and Thor. I need to be able to see a father who lost his wife and the son who lost his mother have a resolution. And I don't get it. Instead, I get two brothers who are manipulating again. And I've got no reason to, like, you know, I come out of it going tee-hee instead of crying, you know, and not that I would have necessarily been crying at that moment anyway, but they're two different emotions. And so I feel, that's where I feel the robbery comes in.
Yeah. It has a very, very different effect.
Yeah.
I'm not I'm not saying that, that Loki is now, and I keep using the word differentiated, that really is a word that refers to our ability to create and maintain a solid emotional sense of self. So you're not, I'd say that somebody who's differentiated is able to separate their emotions from their rationality. And they're also able to differentiate themselves from other people. So when other people harm them or threaten them, that yes, it impacts them, but they're able to to secure a solid sense of self. They can bounce back from that. They can integrate that. They're not sort of in this fragile personhood. And Loki is, as you can imagine, poorly differentiated. He's, in fact, his constant shape-shifting and lack of boundaries and it literally jumping from place to place is sort of a magical way to symbolize his lack of differentiation. So when you think about the way that he utilizes other people's bodies and he utilizes magic and he uses illusion to get his way, I completely agree with you that this was a manipulative, an emotionally manipulative way for him to rule Asgard, at least for some time. What I'm also adding is that the grayness to this is that he's still a person who is lacking that approval and validation from his family members and found a way to connect deeply and meaningfully with his brother in doing this. Now, why didn't he just banish him? Why didn't he, as Odin, say, you know, you essentially committed treason?
Again, in the same way that I banished you in the first movie, I'm going to do it again.
And then he could rule his own, you know, like there are other things he could have done. He chose to do something that was heartfelt. And that's, I think, where we learn a little bit more about Loki. And then I agree with you that as a film, this is cheap. Like, this feels certainly cheap at the end of the movie. We want, and we will get later on, more of those moments with Odin.
But if you're also being manipulative, if you're talking about the Machiavellian keep your enemies or keep your friends close and your enemies closer, if you're talking about... So what did we see happen in Thor? Odin banished Thor and Thor did everything he could to get back to Asgard.
Yeah.
To stop Loki. If Odin banishes Thor again, there's no reason to believe that Thor won't do everything he can to get back to Asgard one way or another. Even if it means using his friends and allies to overthrow, quote unquote, Odin. But in this case, if you just let him go on his own, you have less of a chance that Thor is going to be any of the wiser and coming back on a regular basis to Asgard.
What would he have there?
Yeah. You're giving him the opportunity to go live his best life, knowing that Asgard's always here for you and I'm always going to be the nice king that you have no reason to believe is your brother.
And letting Thor go nicely with his hammer is also a good choice.
And by the way, it's the only choice. Manipulatively, it's the only choice. It would have immediately outed.
Yeah, I mean, imagine Loki as Odin, not being Odin. Odin is the only other person at this time who can hold the hammer. Yeah. So that would have revealed the trickery. So
if he hands,
don't
him,
give me that hammer. I can't. I can't like, even lift it.
No, no, it's yours.
Yeah, it was good.
Ooh, that's yours. You should keep that.
Okay, yeah. So you know, I think we might disagree about the ending of this movie.
We don't disagree. We acknowledge one another's points of view. We just took different things out of it. I think the movie should be called Thor Dark World, and you think the movie should be called Loki Dark World.
Yeah, yeah. That's fair.
Okay. You liked this movie better than I. I think we can say is safe to say. We are back to analyzing Loki as Loki in the prime timeline, so forget everything you heard in our previous episode about the Loki TV show, because that's not the same Loki. That being said, you do have an article that you wrote about Loki. You mentioned it earlier. Where can folks find your article about Loki?
They can find the article about Loki on fandom.com.
Fandom.com. So go find that. And you've got something else to announce, don't you?
So the movie Halloween Kills is out today.
Yeah, because it's Halloween time.
It
so
is
I guess
a couple weeks
sense,
before
yeah.
Halloween. If you've seen Halloween Kills, or actually if you've not seen Halloween Kills, you might enjoy my article about the psychology of Michael Myers and Laurie Strode. So
mostly about Laurie Strode,
but
not necessarily a whole lot of psychology about Michael Myers himself.
He's a serial killer, and he victimizes Laurie Strode. So the article is mainly about survivorship, vis-a-vis the character Laurie Strode, and some elements of repeated trauma, especially when it's trauma related to something so horrific. She was victimized by the serial killer. She survived his attacks. And as the movies have shown us, there have been decades of trauma responses in terms of what we see on screen.
And we should say that when we say the movies, you skipped all of the movies except for you basically went from Halloween to Halloween. You analyzed Laurie in Halloween, the first movie, and then we got rid of all the funky continuity that makes no sense in all those really bad sequels. And then you picked up with the recent Halloween remake, or not remake, but sequel, where Laurie Strode is now Sarah Connor. And now its sequel, mm-hmm. Halloween Kills. So you really do get an opportunity to see victim to badass woman who's prepping for...
Yes, post-traumatic growth.
Yeah.
So the article, and you're right, I didn't have to watch those films in between because apparently the continuity is all bonkers, over the place, right?
And you learn things that just should never have been a thing.
So what I did is I took the first and the most recent film, and mainly I focused on the things that are more realistic in our world. Like, obviously, a lot of what happens is through the lens of horror.
Yeah.
But some of those things could be relatable and important. Things like re-traumatization, reenacting trauma. Things like addiction and other behaviors that follow this kind of traumatic assault. And then, you know, of course, the idea of anniversaries of trauma. So Halloween, the night of Halloween, being a trigger for Laurie Strode. It is the anniversary of this horrific event. And how does that impact her as a survivor? What does that mean for her? Some may say, hey, it's just another day in the calendar.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of reasons why she cannot overcome the memory of this event because it happened on such a memorable day. So if folks want to learn more about that, that's also on fandom.com.
Yeah, we will link to it with the show. Drea, why don't you let the folks know where they can find you online?
They can find me on my website, drdreapsychology.com, and on Instagram and Twitter at Arkham Asylum Doc.
Find me on Twitter at bward028, on Instagram at b_ward028. You can find us both at Arkham Sessions on Twitter, at The Arkham Sessions on Instagram. Follow our family over at Fanbase Press for all of their news, podcasts, and comics. And next time, we will be diving into the next movie in the cinematic universe, which is what?
Captain America, Winter Soldier.
You're absolutely right. It is Captain America, Winter Soldier. So we're going to take a look at that and give our analysis of that. In the meantime, come join us on Patreon because we got a couple things coming out. Tomorrow, actually, you and I are going to sit down and watch The Long Halloween, both parts, and we're going to release that podcast to our patrons only. And then we've got a couple of episodes of Batman Beyond coming back to Patreon. So take a chance to go over to Patreon and join our tiers that allow you to hear exclusive podcasts and get our audio and video reactions to Batman Beyond. Let's thank some of the patrons who have made this episode possible. We've got Weffy, Eric O'Sullivan, Christopher Bauer, Zach Neal, Zachary Hunter, Michael Pruitt, Desert Singer, Dr. Girlfriend, Maria Diego, Nick Gilbert, My Father, Carl Ward, Jay Griffin Hughes, Dr. Jerome Anderson, and Todd Stashwick. Until next time, I'm Brian Ward.
I'm Dr. Drea Letamendi.
And together we are...
The Arkham Sessions.
5 to go.